Good morning and welcome to Christ by the Sea United Methodist Church and our streaming worship service. We hope today that you have prepared a worship table in your house, some bread, a bit of juice or wine, so that you can partake in the Holy Sacrament with us. Today is Trinity Sunday. It's a very special day in the Christian year. It always comes right after Pentecost, and it's as though our liturgy is saying, here's the Father, here's the Son, now the Holy Spirit. And this is our day to celebrate the big picture, all of God's majesty and glory. And so it's a big task before us. I don't know if we can conceive of it, but we can certainly worship the reality of the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So will you pray with me? Father, we thank you for this occasion, this day, this time to pray and open ourselves to the full reality, the whole counsel of God. We ask you, O God, to enter into us, to animate our worship, and in doing so, transform us and change us forever. We pray all this in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Please join me in the call to worship. Everlasting God, you have revealed yourself as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and ever live and reign in the perfect unity of love. Grant that we may always hold firmly and joyfully to this faith and living in praise of your divine majesty. May finally be one in you, who are three persons, in one God, forever and ever. Amen. us unite together in this modern confession of the Christian faith. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who was created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Amen. God of grace and mercy, we offer our gifts to you this day, knowing that it is your love and presence that have sustained us through all our difficult days. We know there have been days when fear and anxiety have gotten the better of us, and we have needed the reminder Paul gave in the Epistle to the Romans, if God is for us, who is against us? Help us to live as Christ calls us, to share what we have, and show love and compassion as Christ taught us. We boldly pray in the name of Jesus, our Savior and Redeemer. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Diana. That was beautiful. This morning, as we prepare our hearts to come before the Lord in prayer, I just want to say that I feel encouraged today. I'm glad that the smoke of rioting and looting seem to be passing away. And while the protests are growing stronger, so is our conversation about racism and about Black Lives Matter and about the proper way for us to define a just society. I trust that these conversations will go on for a long time, but they are good that we are having them rather than destroying ourselves. And so today, I was reminded of many of the words of Martin Luther King, and I want to use them to frame our prayers for our nation and our church. We remember the conviction of Martin Luther King that freedom is never voluntarily given by the oppressor, that it must be demanded by the oppressed. Therefore, let us pray for the courage and determination by those who are oppressed. We remember Martin's warning that a negative peace, which is the absence of tension, is less than a positive peace, which is the presence of justice. And so, Father, we pray for those who work for peace in our world. We pray for those who cry out for justice. We pray for everyone on the front line in our world and in our nation who are laboring to keep us safe and looking for that day when we will all sit down together as equal partners. Lord, far from being disturbed by the presence of the church, we confess that the power structure of the average community is consoled by our silent and often vocal sanction of things as they are. Therefore, we pray that neither this congregation nor any congregation of Christ's people will ever be silent in the face of wrong, but that we will be disturbers of the status quo when that is God's call to us. Father, we pray that we will be delivered from a self-righteousness that makes so many compromises and from selfishness that gains by the oppression of others. O Lord, deliver us from the lust of money or power or things that take top priority in our imagination. Instead, give us a vision of the age to come. Fire our hearts and our eyes and our ears so that we might gain an intimation of this new world that is coming to us. We pray, O God, that our ears may be filled with your promises, our eyes may behold your justice, and our thoughts ever beyond your love for all humanity. Free us from suspicions and fears that stand in the way of that moment, and bring us to reconciliation. We pray, O Lord, that you fill our mouths with words that encourage. We pray, O God, that our speech might be blessing. In short, we pray that we would be the very presence of Christ in our world today. For we ask this all in Jesus' name, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen. So then, today is Trinity Sunday, and it is my privilege to stand before you and preach this doctrine, to tell you that the triune God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Now, you might never find the word Trinity in the scriptures, but we see this triune reality again and again and again. It shows up, it makes an appearance, it walks across the stage. And so we focus on this incredible vision of the church. In fact, so important, I have here what we call in the United Methodist tradition the Articles of Religion. Article 1, the first and foremost doctrine or belief that is set before us. And it reads like this, Article 1 of Faith in the Holy Trinity. There is but one living and true God, everlasting, without body or parts, of infinite power, wisdom, and goodness, the maker and preserver of all things, both visible and invisible. And in the unity of this Godhead, there are three persons of one substance, power, and eternity, the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen and amen. Now, that's the good news. The bad news is that I graduated from theology school on academic probation. I barely got out of there, and when I read something like I just read to you, I have to focus on it, sort of like a manual on how to put an IKEA entertainment center together. It just absolutely befuddles me. I stare at one piece, one statement, and wonder how they all fit together. In fact, for many of us, the doctrine of the Trinity is pretty rough sledding, and quite typically we ask a pastor or a Sunday school teacher to please explain it to me, because it seems so abstract, so otherworldly. And one of the explanations that is usually brought front and center immediately is one that St. Patrick gave us. St. Patrick famously held up a shamrock with three leaves and said, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, each leaf, but it's the same God. Now, I got to tell you, I think that's a terrible explanation of the Trinity, because it makes it seem as though the Father is one-third of the Godhead and that they're somehow connected together but different. And that's not what the creed tells us at all. And so today, my friends, if you're looking for me to explain something like the Trinity, you've come to the wrong church service. Instead, what I'm going to do is read a portion of Scripture and see where the Trinity shows up. Because occasionally in my lifetime, I have become aware of the power of the Trinity, sometimes in ways that have staggered me. Years ago, many years ago, when I was a hospital chaplain, I was called to a family who were about to be informed of the death of their father. His death was unexpected. In fact, he had come to the hospital for surgery, and because there wasn't time to get him into the surgical suite, he simply died before anything could be done. And so we were brought into a very narrow room, and it was a big family. And they were big people. They looked to be truckers or mechanics. You could see grease on their hands and muscles on their arms. And they spoke absolutely no English at all. The doctor poked his head in the room with a translator and informed them that their father had died. The children, who were about my age and twice as big as me, gave a great moan and then focused on me and began to move toward me in anger, threateningly. I didn't know what to do. And so, I don't know why I did this, but I closed my eyes and I said, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And when I opened my eyes, that family was kneeling on the ground. And I was able to put my arms around them. That may sound like a miraculous event, but I tell you, my friends, it is the power of the Trinity. It is the full reality of God's love that we have before us today. So let me read to you a section of the scripture from Paul's letter to the Romans, the 8th chapter, beginning with the 12th verse. It reads like this. So then, brothers and sisters, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very same Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children of God, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. This is the word of God. So, Paul's writing to the Romans about how to get along in life, how to do this thing called living in a way that's radical and different and exhilarating and ultimately life-giving. But before he does that, he gives us a warning not to live according to the flesh. Don't be debtors to the flesh. That's a good place to start, because I think everybody at some point has been in debt, right? I mean, a mortgage, a car payment, some student loans, a credit card here, Another one. For many people, the experience of modern life is that they are right up to here in debt. And it's a hard life. It's a hard life where you're just dog paddling, trying to keep your head above water. And even though you live in a country filled with riches and toys and technological marvels, that sense of having to constantly keep your head above water underlies everything else. And it's not just you. The bank that issued you that credit card, they're wavering too now. And the car that you borrowed money to buy, that manufacturer stands on the brink of solvency. I mean, just barely making it. It's something that affects all of us. And Paul says that walking indebted to the flesh is why Christ came to save us. Because it is the way that ultimately leads to death. We live frantic lives from pillar to post, trying to keep the wheels spinning. And yet, it's a life that becomes ever more desperate. Perhaps you've been there. Perhaps you're even there now, even as a believer, because he warns us as believers not to fall back into this life. Instead, Paul says that we should have a different kind of indebtedness, not to the flesh, but rather to the Spirit. And this makes all the difference in the world. My friends, when we understand that we are in debt to the Spirit, that is, when everything we have, everything we own, everything that God has blessed us with is all gift of God's Spirit. More importantly, what lies within us, when we have a good hold of that, when we are, as Paul puts it, led by the Spirit, then we receive something that's extraordinary. Paul says we become children of God. Now, these days, I think we use, at least we Christians, use that phrase, children of God, a little too loosely. To be sure, we are all God's offspring, as it says in the book of Acts. We are all creators. God has created all of us, and by that fact, we belong to him. But to have this special, intimate, loving knowledge of God as a child, well, that's something else. You remember the parable of the prodigal son? How that younger son hated his father, despised him, just wanted to get the money and run. And it wasn't until much later in the story and in his life when he saw his father with open arms, did he realize that he was a child of his father. Do you have that knowledge today? Is that your primary touchstone? Is that the truth that you know, that you know, that you know? Because from that truth, a different kind of life springs. And by the way, watch for the Trinity suddenly to emerge. Because Paul says that we're not only, in the Greek, it says, we're not only sons, but heirs. Now, he's not being sexist. The point is, back in ancient times, the heir, the oldest son of the family, was the one who inherited almost everything. And there could be only one heir because the family name, the family business had to go forward. But check out what Paul is saying to each one of us, that all of us, every last one of us, are given the opportunity to become sons and, yes, even heirs. Even the women among us suddenly have the opportunity to step into this legal reality called sonship. Paul was twisting words and making mouths agape in amazement at the providence of God. But then, and watch for it, we become heirs and co-heirs with Christ. The Spirit leads us into a relationship with Jesus Christ. And it's prefigured when he sits at table with them at the Last Supper. And he lets them know that they are friends, not slaves, not people just to take orders, not gophers in the kingdom of God, but truly friends. And then at the resurrection, Jesus returns and refers to them as brothers, kin. And so we find this idea of Trinity is not simply a doctrine that we have to imagine or figure out or ponder upon, but in fact, it's a gateway into becoming part of the family of God. Now, the amazing thing about all of this is what God, in his great love, offers us. First of all, as he says right here, he sends us the Spirit, crying out in our hearts, Abba, Father. And now the Trinity is before us clearly, not as some theological construct, but a passionate embrace from our own heart, deep speaking to deep, God crying out within us to God himself. And so the Christian life isn't merely some person who believes thus and so about Jesus trying to work it out on their own, but in fact they become an instrument in God's hands so that we might play a beautiful hymn of praise to the Father, crying out with our hearts and living in salvation and knowing the assurance that we are indeed heirs of that age to come. Oh, my friends, the doctrine of the Trinity is an incredible assurance to me. In fact, it's part of our Methodist heritage. The founder of Methodism, John Wesley, was a missionary in Georgia. He was full of zeal and wanted to do so much for God, but he was living in the flesh. He was trying to do it all his own. He went to Georgia. He was a horrible missionary. He was a terrible example for the kingdom of God until he went back in disgrace to England. And one day, somehow, somewhere in London, he heard somebody reading something from Martin Luther's works. And we can't explain it. We don't understand it, but Wesley said, I felt my heart strangely warmed, and I realized that God loved me, that Christ died for me. He was so convicted by this, he called it the assurance of salvation. That is, the Spirit whispers and sometimes shouts in our hearts, that despite everything else going on, despite the economy, despite our relationships, despite the ins and outs of our lives, the ups and downs, through it all, God takes delight in us as beloved children. And that becomes for us primary reality. And so, my friends, I want to share with you today that the Trinity is not just a doctrine. It's more like the promised land, except in this case, it's not some piece of geography that we're entering. It's not even a place somewhere in heaven that we're hoping for. It is God's very self that we are traversing and walking through. This is our journey. It is the big picture the great big picture. And my friends, all of this is for me and for you. All of this was won for us on the cross. I invite you today, as we break bread and share in the cup, to invite this triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, to come and make their dwelling place in our hearts. Let us pray. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, triune God, world without end, we cannot believe that we have become heirs to this and joint heirs with Christ. Thank you for your providence, your amazing love. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Joan, will you lead us in the order for Holy Communion?
This is our invitation to communion and our prayer of confession and forgiveness. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another.
Merciful God,
we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Father, we bless you and we glorify you. Because holy and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church and delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. So on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, he gave thanks to you, and he broke that bread, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said to them, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. You do this in remembrance of me." Then when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you and gave it to his disciples. And he said to them, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, Father, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. So, Father, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, so that we might be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Thank you, dear. The body of Christ broken for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. Amen. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus broken and shed for you. Amen. Well, this is a love that excels all love. So I invite you to join us and sing Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. Amen.
Jesus, Thou art all compassion.
What an amazing blessing of music that Diana and Marcos, you have shared with us today. We are doubly blessed. And now, I've said this before, but it is the only benediction I will use today. Go forth from this place in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.